Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, and our text will begin in verse number 1. And let's see what the Apostle Paul has written here in the first several verses. He said, "This is the third time." Sounds almost like frustrated, doesn't it? I mean, you wouldn't normally say something like that if you were excited. Oh boy, this is the third time. It almost sounds a little frustrating. You know, "This is the third time I've written to you." Well, "This is the third time I'm coming to you. In the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. I told you before." Doesn't that sound like "I told you"? "I told you before and foretell you as if I were present the second time, and being absent now, I write to them which heretofore have sinned, and to all other that if I come again, I will not spare." I remember somebody saying, I wrote it down next to it, "Throw strikes." "I will not spare. Since ye seek a proof of Christ speaking in me, which to you ward is not weak, but is mighty in you. For though he was crucified through weakness, yet he liveth by the power of God. For we also are weak in him, but we shall live with him by the power of God toward you. Examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates?" Yeah. Examine yourselves. Father, we thank you for your word here tonight. Pray your blessing upon it. And Lord, may the word of God go forth and encourage and convict and accomplish something eternal in each one that listens tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You know, our text here brings up, here's really the basis for, they're calling into question the apostleship of Jesus, of the Apostle Paul here. And the Corinthians were, as it says, seeking a proof. That's what it says in what, verse 3 there? They were seeking a proof of Christ speaking in him. You know, are you really getting this from God? And Paul's response was, "Examine yourselves." In other words, he's saying, "You're the proof. You're the proof that I am an apostle of Jesus Christ." And, well, if that is the case, and that's what Paul is saying to them, then when he says, "Examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith," he's actually saying to them, if you see some results in your own life, if you have been established, then what you say you believe and what you actually believe ought to have some evidence to it. And so, you know, we wonder sometimes, or at least we should wonder, you know, am I pleasing in your sight? I preached a message years ago. Remember, it was, "Does the Lord like you?" You know, because that's what the Bible said about, I think it was David, said that he liked me. And, you know, we all know, oh, God loves us. And, you know, and we know a lot of family and people, and we love them because they're part, but some of them we don't like. And so Paul here is at a place where he's really trying to encourage them in the fact that if you're saved, not so much if, because he knows that they're saved, because he's writing to the church here, but he said, "You're questioning me, you're the very evidence. You're the evidence of the fact that you believed and you're a new creature in Jesus Christ. And you know, show it. It ought to be visible. I read this illustration. I thought it was kind of funny. David came home from the third grade art class with this report. They told us how to draw ourselves, he said. But without a mirror, I ended up drawing a total stranger. And you know what? That's pretty much what we would be guilty of. If someone were to say, you know, tell us something about you or draw a picture of you. You know, sometimes we'll say something like, if you look this up in the dictionary, you know, maybe it's some positive thing or maybe some negative thing, and they'll say that so-and-so's picture is right alongside of that. And we have a tendency, we all do, to think a little more highly of ourselves than we ought to think. But that doesn't mean that we ought not to occasionally think about ourselves and wonder, Lord, am I doing okay? Am I kind of pleasing in your sight? And there's only a way to accomplish that, and it's, as Paul said here, examine yourselves. And so, in the faith, see, he says, examine yourselves whether ye be in the faith. And a lot of people have misinterpreted that to mean to see whether or not you're saved. But that's not what it's referring to. In the faith means the faith is the body of revealed truth, which is really doing what this book says. And that's something that we can, well, Jesus said, ye shall know them by their fruits. So the fruit of our lives, you know, like Paul said in Galatians 2:20, he spoke of, I'm crucified with Christ. He said, nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. In the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. And of course, when you're looking at the example that would, or I should say the fruit of the Spirit, according to Paul again, is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. That ought to be exhibited. And anyone ought to be able to see that. We ought to be able to see it in ourselves and know whether or not we're lacking in any of that area. Colossians 2 in verse 6 and 7 says, as ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him. In other words, if what you're claiming is true, then do it. Show it. He said, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Notice that he's writing to save people and he's asking them to be rooted and built up and established in the faith. He's not talking about them getting saved. He's talking about the body of revealed truth. What has been shown to you, what you claim to believe and claim that you're living, he said, let's see it. Let's see it. Colossians 1 in verse 20 to 23, he says, and having made peace through the blood of his cross, that's our salvation, right? He said, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, and you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet hath he now reconciled, there's our salvation, in the body of his flesh through death, to present you, this is his intent, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. If we demonstrate to ourselves and others what has taken place in us, then God is going to be able to present us at the judgment seat of Christ and to the Father. He's going to be able to present a people who is holy, unblameable, unreprovable in his sight. If ye continue in the faith. He's not saying, you know, if you don't, you know, a lot of people again misinterpret this and they say, well, that's you could walk away. You could, you know, if you don't continue, if you don't endure to the end, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which ye have heard and which was preached to you, every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, and made a minister. So he's saying to them here, to the Corinthians, he said, examine yourselves. Examine yourselves. And because you can learn a lot by examining yourself. There's a lot of medical professionals that tell people to do that. You need to do a little self-examination. Women are told to do that, for their breast. So do a self-examination. Men are told that for possibility of testicular cancer and all that stuff. You know, a self-examination. Because it reveals a lot. You'll know other people looking at you. They're not going to know this stuff. They can't determine that. But you know it. And so it is even in the spiritual realm. A lot of times we can don the suit, grab the book, and show up, sing the songs, and no one knows. Everyone thinks, well, they're okay. We're all okay. But you know, down deep, you know whether or not you're spiritually what you ought to be. A self-examination is an examination into one's own state, conduct, motives, etc. Medically, it's an examination of one's body for signs of illness or distress. Breast self-examination, testicular exam. These exams, or these types of exams, provide you with personal information. Personal information that no one else is mindful of. So if we examine ourselves, we would like to determine the condition of our health, physically, but likewise in our faith. If we would prove ourselves to know if we're still in alignment with God's word, with his word and his will here, it would be informative and it would also be private. No one would know. And so you could make necessary adjustments day in and day out and get back in line with the Lord, and no one's the wiser. You are. And we ought to do this regularly. And so what is it that we can do? I just made a list of different things that we could check to see a self-examination of our own spiritual lives as to determine whether or not we're in the faith. And again, I'm not talking about determining your salvation. Salvation was a decision that you made when you trusted Christ as your Savior. You got in, born again. And as newborn babes, we're desiring now to grow thereby. Seek the word and grow thereby. So that's our goal. But how do you gauge it? It's not up to each other to look at each other and say, well, I think they're a little lacking. I've been watching you lately, Doc, and I noticed a couple of things out of line. Let me jot a few things down for you here. See if you can, this week, see if you can work on these things, will you? No. We're supposed to undertake those things. We're the ones that are supposed to say, you know what? I said something. I did something. I don't feel something like I should. Lord, what's up with that? Let me give you several things here. Number one, ask yourself this. If you're going to do a self-examination, you know, they give you instructions on how to do this physically, right? I've seen the charts that they give to women to do breast exams, and you have to hold your, you know, you have to like do some crazy thing where you stand on one foot and do whatever it is. But they give you instruction on how to do it. Well, God wants to give us some instruction on how to determine whether or not you're spiritually in line, whether you're in the faith. And again, no one needs to know what's going on, but physically, don't we sometimes wonder? Before we ever go to the doctor, we've already determined in our, I think there's something wrong there, Doc. I got a lump, or I've got a pain, or I've got a, this, something doesn't feel right. Well, why don't we think that way? Why don't we feel that way with spiritual things? And you know, say, you know, why don't I want to do that? There's got to be a reason for it if we're saved. You know that the Spirit of God is inside of us saying, hey, you up there. Let's get with the program. First thing to ask yourself is, am I spirit-led? Who's leading me? And we sing the song, He leadeth me. Well, do we really mean it? Or is it a song? Romans 8:14 says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. So if you're a son of God, then Jesus ought to be leading the way. And you ought to let him lead. Luke 4 and verse 1, Bible says, Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. So if you're filled with the Spirit of God, as we would claim that, oh yes, I'm filled with the Spirit, then Jesus ought to be leading the way. Because that's what the Spirit did even with Jesus himself. I'll give you some other things too. I've got a few. How about, am I striving? Ask yourself this. Am I striving to please God? I mean, am I trying to please myself or am I trying to please God? Am I trying to please others? Am I a man pleaser? Or do I really care about pleasing God? 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 1 says, furthermore, then we beseech you, brethren, and exhort you by the Lord Jesus, that as ye have received of us how ye ought to walk and to please God, so ye would abound more and more. You know, as life goes on, we ought not to be referring to the time. There was a time about 10 years ago, I think I did something for God. No, I mean, we ought to be, as he's saying here, abounding more and more. Am I striving to please God? Hebrews 11. That was Enoch's ticket out of here. Because he had a testimony. It says in Hebrews 11 and verse 5 and 6, by faith, Enoch was translated that he should not see death and was not found because God had translated him, and before his translation, he had this testimony that he pleased God. But without faith, notice it's tied together, but without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to him must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So, just a little checklist. Am I spirit led? Is the Spirit leading me? Am I pleasing God? Am I doing things that are pleasing in the sight? How about this? Am I aware that God can see me? it's amazing how most people will conduct themselves properly if somebody else is around watching. I remember somebody saying this years ago. They said, you know who you really are? It's the person that exists when no one else is around. That's the real you. When you're all by yourself. The things that you do, the things that you see, the things that you say, all of those, that's the real you. The one that you portray in front of other people, that's not really you. So you know what that says about coming to church? Most of the people that are coming to church and we're saying hello to them, it's not really them. It's a reasonable facsimile. It's somebody else. We only think that we're talking to the real them. But in Genesis 16 and verse 13, remember Hagar? Now, this Egyptian, outcast, you would think, who would pay any attention to her? And yet, the Bible says in verse 13, and she called the name of the Lord that spake unto her, thou God seest me, she said. For she said, have I also here looked after him that seeth me? Speaking of Ishmael. She understood, as a lost Egyptian, she understood that God, he sees what's going on. Well, I hope people today can get a hold of the fact that God sees what's going on right now. And he's probably looking for people to turn to him. Psalm 139, here's old King David. You would think that he'd get a pass. David didn't get a pass. And he understood that. He said in verse 7 and 8, whither shall I go from thy spirit? Or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, he said, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. No matter where I go, God, there you are. There you are and there I am. We're doing a checklist here tonight, a little self-examination of, am I in the faith? Am I following along? Am I okay, Lord? How about this? Do I read and love the Bible? Do I read and love the Bible? Psalm 119 and verse 140 says, "Thy word is very pure." See, that's the statement. That's the place, the vantage point where you appreciate it. It says, "Thy word is very pure. Therefore, thy servant loveth it." Because we know how good it is, how wholesome it is, how perfect it is. We say, you know what? I love that. I love that. 2 Timothy 1 and verse 13, Paul tells Timothy here, he said, "Hold fast the form of sound words." Well, what's the sound words that we have? The Word of God, right? He said, "Which thou hast heard of me in faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus." I mean, he's saying, hang on to that because you love it. And we ought to love it. Do I live in the spirit of prayer? Do I live in the spirit of prayer? I answered this question this morning to an inquisitive mind. You know, we sometimes are dismissive of it because we say, well, it can't mean. When he says, 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. Well, you can't do that. But if that's the instruction, then there's got to be a means of doing it, right? It's not getting down on your knees and saying an endless prayer. Matter of fact, vain repetitions, as far as God is concerned, he said, they think they'll be heard for their much speaking. But he's dismissive of that. He just wants you to talk to him, communicate with him. Be ready to speak with him in a moment's notice. Kind of like Steve when he wears those, whatever, are they called earbuds? Is that what they call them? When you wear it. Now, is he on the phone all the time? I hope not. But he's ready and able to be in contact immediately. And that's what God's talking about when we're praying without ceasing. When it says in Ephesians 6:18, praying always with all prayer and supplication. Well, we're just, you know, you're going along and you see something, and you say, "Oh Lord, I appreciate that. And that's nice. Well, you did that, didn't you? Look at that person over there. Lord, looks like to me they could use some help over there. Could you help them a little?" There's been a lot of times where I've walked past somebody that just did not fare all that well in a lot of the physical, emotional, mental health handouts of life. And as I walked by them, and I thought to myself, you know, you'd see somebody in a wheelchair or something like that, and you think to yourself, "Lord, could you just help them? Could give them a good day or something?" That's the kind of praying that we're supposed to be doing, not saying, "Oh, let's see, what time is it? All right, it's time for me to pray. Get down there and just rant on and on and on and on." Because when you do that, the Lord probably say, "Are you about done?" He just wants to be in constant contact with you. Sounds like that's when you know you got something going. Do I deny myself for Christ? Who's number one? You've heard that expression, right? You got to look out for number one. Yeah, but guess who number one is? I'll tell you who number one is. It's him. He's supposed to have the preeminence in all things. In Mark 8, verse 34, the Bible said, "When he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." That's out of the mouth of Jesus. He said, "You know what? If you really want to follow me, then you have to deny yourself. Because this old flesh doesn't want to follow him." His old this flesh wants to do every other thing imaginable but to follow him. Titus 2 in verse 11 to 13 says, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us, that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. But it's teaching us that we ought to deny ungodliness and worldly lust. In other words, stop deny yourself, because we're always attracted to some ungodly, worldly thing. It's always, everywhere we go, it's some influence going, hey, over here, over here. Wasn't there a TV show years ago where they had some kid in the classroom go, ooh, 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 ooh. Yeah, that what it was? Yeah. But those are the influences all around us. Everywhere we go, there's something saying, ooh, 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 ooh. And we're daffy enough to go, oh, I'll be right back, Lord. How about this one? Do you love to talk about the Bible? Yeah, I've been involved in a lot of things where that conversation will take up and you immediately watch people start going. They kind of like mosey on into the conversation and then they, listen a little bit. But then once they determine, oh, this is getting a little heavy, and they just kind of quietly bow out. Malachi 3:16 says, and they that feared the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance, he said, was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. We don't talk about him like we could or like we should. Amen. We talk about all kinds of other things, and every now and then he'll come up in the subject. We reserve that for church. But we really could talk about him all. There was an instruction given to Israel back in Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 6 to 9. I wonder how well that would go for the church today. He said, these words, which I command thee this day, shall be in thine heart. I think we would say, stop right there. But he said, it should be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children. Well, that's why I sent them to Sunday school. And shall talk of them when thou sittest in thine house. Talk about them at home? No, we do that at church. And when thou walkest by the way, when you go to Walmart, and when thou liest down, and when thou riseth up. Not only that, but bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and shall be frontlets between thine eyes, and thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on the gates. Boy, I'll tell you, the Word of God sounds to me like the Bible ought to have a lot more influence in our lives than it does. We're just looking at, we're doing a self-examination. Now, are every one of us at the top of our game in all these areas? Probably not. But if you're trying to gauge where do I fit in on the spiritual ladder, these are the kinds of things we really have to ask ourselves. Now, how long have we been saved? What church do we attend? I mean, those are important things, but they're not how you're going to gauge what kind of a Christian you are. Just a couple more. Do I have a burden for lost souls? I'll tell you, it's a tough thing to look at the world and not get frustrated and aggravated by wicked, sinful behavior around you. Rather than have your heart broken and say, oh, Lord, man, you died for that. That needs to be saved. You love them, because we've been saved for a while and we think, well, I've made some progress. I've cleaned up myself. But look at that. Oh, imagine that. But think about how probably some people looked at us before we got saved. They probably thought the same thing. But the Bible says in Psalm 126 and verse 5 and 6, they that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. I don't think we cry a whole lot. Right now, think about it. I'll be honest, I turn on the news daily. I mean, this has been going on and on and on. But I have to tell you, I haven't looked at a lot of these crowds, these looters, and think to myself, oh, God, save their souls. I haven't been thinking like that. I've been thinking other things. I've been thinking along the lines of, boy, I wish that was my store. I mean, really, I mean, but that's the people. That's Jesus Christ came to save sinners. And so when we see sin going on, it's a reminder to us that that's what he came to do. Paul said to the Thessalonians, he said in 1 Thessalonians 2 in verse 17 to 20, he said, but we, brethren, being taken from you for a short time in presence, not in heart, endeavored the more abundantly to see your face with great desire. Wherefore, we would have come unto you, even I, Paul, once and again, but Satan hindered us. For what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ that is coming? For ye are our glory and joy. He's looking at these people that have been saved, people that he had a direct involvement in bringing them to Christ. And he's looking at them and said, man, you're my joy. You're my crown of rejoicing. I take a lot of joy in seeing you and the transformation in your lives. I won't stay on this one too long. Do I faithfully assemble with my local church? Now, I know I'm probably preaching to the choir here tonight, but some people don't. Some people's church attendance is so hit or miss, so matter of fact. It's kind of unfortunate. You know, coming together is really the beginning. Coming together in the church, I mean, anybody can come in and sit down, sing a song, and go home. That's why I find, you know, you hear sometimes people say, well, I didn't go to church the other day. Well, how come? I was tired. Tired? Tired? Louis, are you working up a sweat right there? I mean, you come in, you sit down, and you sit there the whole time. I mean, it'd be one thing if we made people run laps. Yeah. But I don't know how tuckered out people get just sitting in a padded pew. Yeah. If anyone ought to use the excuse, I'm tired, it ought to be me. I'm the one that's got to stand up for hours on end. And I see it more as I get older. Man, I went downstairs this afternoon, and after everyone left and everything, the first thing I did was I found a place and I sat down. It's like, oh man, I'm standing up for the last, I don't know, 4.5 hours. Time to sit down. Well, tired. But coming together, that's just the start. Hebrews 10 and verse 25 says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. That's just getting started. Keeping together is progress. It is. Ephesians 4 and verse 3 says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. That's how you know you're making some progress here. To just come to church, that's... Man, if that's your claim to fame, your self-examination ought to do something for you at that point. But keeping together and then working together, that's even more. That shows that you've got some success. When people are willing to come together and stick together and work together, now you know you're cooking. And how about this one? I'll close on this one. Am I living each day expecting to meet Jesus? Or are we dreading it? Are we saying things like, Just a little bit longer there, Jesus. Not today. You know, I've got some plans. We're going here today. We're going to do this and that. Maybe plan it for some other time. I know it's pertaining to Israel, but in Amos 4 and verse 12, the statement is made, prepare to meet thy God, O Israel. And you know what? The children of God, we ought to be prepared to meet God. We ought to be prepared for the trumpet to sound and go on out of here and be happy and content. Hebrews 12 and verse 1 and 2, wherefore seeing we're also compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, he said, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Titus 2:13, quoted a little earlier in another context, but looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Are you looking for him? The song says, I'm looking for Jesus to come any night, any day, anytime, Lord, perhaps today. Our text this evening is, examine yourselves whether you be in the faith. And then it says, prove your own selves. If you can look in the mirror, and sometimes we're deceived, look in the mirror and say, no, I'm okay. I'm all right. Then prove it. Exhibit all of these characteristics that we talked of this evening. You know you. Nobody knows you physically better than you. Right? You know that little toenail really bugs me. Nobody else knows that. You know that. You know every little ache, pain, itch, you name it, of your body. And the same is true about your spirituality. We can fake each other out. We can put on a happy face and all, but you know down deep in your heart your physical and your spiritual condition. How do you line up with the mirror of God's word? James 1 and verse 23 and 24 said, for if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man beholding his natural face in a glass, for he beholdeth himself and goeth his way and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. O woman. How often should I do that self-examination? You ever ask the doctor that when they tell you you need to self-examine there? You ever ask them, well, how often should I do that? Well, I guess it depends on how healthy do you want to be?
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. In our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study, Wednesday at 7 p.m. You may write to Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church at 214 Main Street, Blackstone, Massachusetts, or call us at area code 508-883-5302. For additional information about our church, please visit our website at solidrockbbc.com. May the message you've heard today speak to your heart, and remember, God loves you, Christ died for you, and you must be born again. Thank you for watching.